Welcome once again, folks, to the Hour of the Ton. This is the only hour that ever was or ever will be. This is the most important hour in your entire life. For during this hour, you will decide your future and thus our collective futures. I am your host, William Cooper. The enemy has struck. One radio show in this country is under all-out attack. Out of tens of thousands of radio talk programs, one and only one has been chosen for destruction. The attack is in the form of an unsigned four-page document that drips with venom and lies. The target? The Hour of the Time. This attack rivals even the best efforts of the old communist propaganda machine. Stay tuned. Yes, folks, the Hour of the Time is under attack. And me personally. It's not the first time, nor, I can assure you, will it be the last. But I must address this four-page slimy document that drips, literally drips, with lies and venom. Because there are too many innocent, unsuspecting people out there who may believe this. Normally, my policy is to ignore this kind of thing. I have been attacked by loony bin, absolutely insane publications like UFO Magazine, which is ludicrous, laughable. That's easy to shrug off. I was attacked by MUFON in the MUFON Journal, where they printed a fraudulent, bogus letter supposedly written by some Air Force colonel to Philip Klass, a well-known UFO debunker. Why? Because it popped their bubble, folks. I've popped their bubble. I've revealed to the world that this whole UFO extraterrestrial thing is nothing more than a ploy to create an external enemy, which they can use to destroy the sovereignty of nations and unite the world in a one-world totalitarian socialist government. And this hurts them, because perpetrating these lies is how they make their money. I have nothing against people making money. But I have everything against deception. Well, that letter was proved to be fraudulent, and in contacting the United States Air Force, it was proven that no such colonel existed or ever did exist. But in that letter, it purported that I was kicked out of the United States Navy under less than honorable conditions. An absolute lie. My service record and my DD-214, my discharge papers, are published in the appendix of my book, folks. And I had very long and honorable service. I was honorably discharged, and during my military service, I earned many citations, awards, and medals for combat. And not only for combat, but for valor in combat. See, two of my medals have the V for valor awarded along with them. So, now we come to this. Whenever these people have attempted to meet me face to face in a debate or in a radio talk show, they have always slunk away with their tail between their legs, hanging their head in shame, because they never have their facts right, they're never prepared, and for some reason they seem to think that I'm going to show up the same way, and I never do. So they resort to these things. We know three things right off the bat about the person who wrote this or the organization that wrote this. One, they are miserable, abject cowards. Miserable, abject cowards because they do not identify themselves, they do not sign their name, they do not print the name or address of their organization. Only cowards do that. Only cowards send anonymous letters, especially when it drips with venom like this. And they know that should they be identified, they would quickly be hauled into court and raked over the coals, and that's exactly what's going to happen if we can find out who they are. So, right now, I'm going to offer a $100 reward for any information on the identity of the people or person who wrote this paper. 4 pages, entitled The Hour of the Crime, or Tricks, Lies, and Videotape. Plus a free membership to CAGI. All total, that's $145, folks. $145. Plus, for the person who can identify the writer of this, I will also throw in our new documentary on the Kennedy assassination that we are just now completing, that nobody's ever seen, that is talked about in this thing, that the author of this lie has never seen, therefore knows nothing about, but attempts to discredit it before it even comes out. That should tell you that they're really worried about this new documentary of mine. You see, folks, nobody goes to this kind of effort to discredit a radio show unless that radio show is damaging to their cause. We are hurting the International Socialist Movement with this radio show. We are hurting those who would destroy the Constitution, this nation, freedom, and freedom for the world. We are hurting them with the information that's broadcast on this radio show. We are hurting them by telling our listeners not to believe what they hear from anyone or what they read from any source unless they can validate it by their own research and their own efforts. You see, because they tend upon your blind obedience and blind belief. They depend upon it. And if they don't have it, they can't control you. They can't make you a puppet on the end of their string. So let's get into this. We're going to go through it. I'm going to read it. And we're going to dispense with this once and for all. Quote, on October 19, 1992, at 10 p.m. Pacific Time, the new worldwide shortwave broadcast of Bill Cooper's Hour of the Time debuted. The first sentence in this is a lie, folks. This show debuted on August the 30th, 1992, on WWCR. It debuted worldwide on satellite SpaceNet 2 Channel 7 7.5 audio on the 4th of May, 1992. So you can see the very, very first sentence of this tome is a lie. Those who have previously identified with the original Behold a Stale Horse document will be even more appalled to learn the following. Behold a Stale Horse was a document written by my stalker. You didn't know it, but I had my own personal stalker. He used to stalk me all around this country until he was reported to the police in Orlando, Florida, the state where he lives, and until we filed suit against him in federal district court in Atlanta, Georgia, and since then he has disappeared. He wrote about a 2-inch thick, absolutely insane ravings called Behold a Stale Horse, a parody of my book. See, my book has damaged them so bad they can't stand it. This person was raised in a cult called the Stele Group or the Stele Society. The Stele is a stone found in Egypt that outlines the entire story of the Osiris cycle, or the legend of Osiris and Isis. They are part of the Great White Brotherhood, the mystery schools, the mystery religion of Babylon. And this person's name, who also claims that he went to El Salvador during the Civil War down there and was shot, wounded. We've done an extended investigation on that and found out he never in his life has been to El Salvador and has never been shot. We even have a copy of his medical record that shows what the real scar really is. His name, folks, Lars Hansen. Now to continue with this document. In his worldwide debut, Mr. Cooper not only beat his tired horse regarding the already exposed fraud perpetrated on the American people in the JFK assassination, but added to his list of culprits responsible were Time Life and Time Warner. Mr. Cooper claims that Time Life, Time Warner worked in league with the CIA to commit fraud by using computers to doctor up the original Zapruder film, again, another lie. On the show on October 19th, folks, I said that we, not Time Life or Time Warner, we, me, and experts, used computers to analyze the Zapruder film, from which we have obtained a first-generation 35mm copy. We used computers to analyze that film. During the analysis, we found that the film had been doctored in many, many areas. And I also made the comment that only a few people had had access to that film. One, of course, was Abraham Zapruder. We don't believe he had anything to do with it. He didn't even have it long enough to do anything with it. The second one was the intelligence community in the National Photographic Laboratory in Washington, D.C., who could have very well doctored the film. And the third was Time Life, who purchased the film from Abraham Zapruder when it was returned to him by the intelligence community. And I said on that show that I didn't know who doctored the film, but whoever doctored it is an accomplice to the Kennedy assassination because they've intentionally doctored the film to cover up what's on that film and maybe to lead us to erroneous conclusions. I also stated in that broadcast that because of that, the film can never be used as evidence of any facts other than it proves beyond any shadow of a doubt that there was a conspiracy and that whoever doctored the film was a part of the conspiracy, whether it be the intelligence community and the National Photographic Laboratory, Abraham Zapruder, or Time Life. That is the truth of what was said on the October 19th, 92 program. Now to continue. Although most researchers in this field on the West Coast are aware of the absolutely pathetic ramblings of Mr. Cooper, and that's during this one short hour broadcast entertainment, he may have managed to outdo even his previous endeavors. Well, that's not true. I know many researchers in the West Coast who agree with me 100% wholeheartedly. Some agree with part of the things that I believe, and some do not agree with others. Some don't agree with anything I say, but this miserable, cowardly group and this miserable, cowardly author pretends to speak for all of these people, and I can tell you again, he or she does not. To continue, during his show, which airs on WWCR Nashville, Tennessee, shortwave 7.435 on the shortwave dial, and thank you very much for advertising my show, because many more listeners will now read this and tune in to hear some of my pathetic ramblings, as you term them, and they will become steady listeners. Says Mr. Cooper again donned his snake oil salesman garb and no doubt sucked in even more of the gullible, non-informed individuals hungry for answers and willing to embrace his stale routine. Well, there, he's called you all stupid, and unfortunately many of you are, but normally not the regular listener to this show. They're usually free thinkers. They are usually leaders. They usually make up their own mind, and they usually do exactly what I tell them to do, and that is not to believe anything they hear or read from any source. Not me, not their mother, not the president, not anyone. My listeners are the ones who make things happen, not people who sit around and watch things happen. Unfortunately, he's right here. Most people are sheep. Most people are stupid, which means mentally crippled. And they're stupid because of 40 years of intense brainwashing through the television, the media, and Hollywood. He also goes on to say here, it is not surprising that Mr. Cooper's newsletter is titled C-A-J-I, pronounced K-G. Again, that's another lie. Those of you who have been listening to this program and those of you who have known me for years ever since I started K-G, know that K-G is the correct pronunciation and not K-G. CAGI, and it stands for the Citizens Agency for Joint Intelligence, the largest and most successful civilian intelligence organization in the world, and I'm very proud that I am the one who set it up, started it, and to this day I administer it. I'm proud of all the people who are CAGI members for the information that they dug out and that we've been able to expose as a result of their efforts. They are truly, in my estimation, heroic and are worthy of great praise. Not the kind of slimy innuendo that comes from this miserable, abject, little racist, socialist coward, whoever wrote this. It goes on to say, with the growing dissatisfaction and decay of trust in our government, and the message on this show is you should not have decay of trust in our constitutionally established government, but you should have mistrust in those who have infiltrated and are trying to destroy our government, our nation, and our Constitution from within. We owe our allegiance to the Constitution and not to individuals. Period. He goes on to say, Mr. Cooper circles over those hungering for answers and sets his sights on this money-making opportunity. Oh, socialism! I would advise these people to go somewhere where they will get everything provided for them by the government. That's what they really want. To go on, then he swoops down, dangles a few hunger-satiating revelations in front of them and says, come, walk with me, for I and I alone can lead you to that promised land. Follow if you will, but don't forget to pack your checkbook. More socialist talk, and you've never heard me say, come walk with me, for I and I alone can lead you to that promised land. You have heard me say you're going to hear information on this show that you will not hear anywhere else, and that is true. That's always been true, and it always will be true, for as long as I'm allowed to have this radio show. And what's all this stuff about checkbook and money-making opportunity? You notice at the end of this, he recommends that you listen to Tom Valentine and Chuck Carter. Both of them do the same thing I do. They sell merchandise on the air. And Chuck Carter has membership that you can join also and sells books and all kinds of stuff and even talks you into coming down, staying in his hotel and eating in his restaurant. But he recommends Chuck Carter and Tom Valentine, but when I do it on my show, there's something wrong with that. This is an old socialist trick, folks, to try to discredit someone who's putting out information because they charge for the information. Yet I bet this same person reveres Oliver Stone and went and paid admission to see that movie and didn't say a thing about it. Well, folks, I'm not going to justify my attempts to support my family and pay the rent and put food on the table because I don't have to. Because every smart person in this world knows what that's all about. And when all you do every day is research and radio shows and travel and lecture to people, then that is the only way that you have of paying the rent and putting the food on the table. And that doesn't work anymore, folks. I am an American. I believe in capitalism, and I do not believe in the socialist ideas of the little twit that wrote this. Remember, there's a $100 reward for the identity of this person, our persons, our organization, plus a free membership to CAGI. To continue, on October 19th, Mr. Cooper detailed how he now has a brand new, never-before-seen version of the Zapruder film. Gee, where have we heard that one before? Well, I never said it was never before seen, but it was never before seen by the public, some of it. The public's seen most of it, but they haven't seen the missing footage at the end and the footage that has been cut out in the middle, and they haven't seen blow-ups of each frame to show them how the film has been doctored. You're going to see it. In my documentary, you'll see it with your own eyes, and then you'll be able to judge it for yourselves. This person's never seen this film, but listen to how they've already judged it, and they already know what's on it, and they're already trying to destroy it, which means this film is extremely threatening to these people. To continue, in this latest revision to his sideshow, Mr. Cooper states that while William Greer still is the one who delivered the fatal headshot, that's what the film shows, folks, On October the 19th, I also said that the film has been extensively doctored, and either William Greer shot the president, or the film has been doctored to make us believe that he shot the president. I also saw in top secret documents while I was a member of Naval Intelligence, way back in 1971, 72, and 73, a document which stated that William Greer shot the president in the head. And I'm not the only one who's seen these documents. A television producer named Linda Moulton Howe was shown the same documents in the Air Force Office of Special Investigation at Kirtland Air Force Base by an intelligence operative named Richard Doty. So I'm not the only one who saw those documents that said that. And either it's true, or those of us who saw those documents or were shown those documents were told that or shown that to make us believe that it was true. And the film shows it. Now, either the film's right, or it's just another incident of how the film has been doctored. And specifically, that section of the film has been extensively doctored, and you'll see that in our documentary. Then he goes on to say here, an even more amazing event occurs just after he has shot the president. Unveiling his new video masterpiece, Mr. Cooper presents his revelation that the entire front windshield of JFK's limousine is blown out and then shatters like dust onto the street in front of a horrified onlookers. That's another lie. I never said the entire windshield was blown out. I never said it shatters like dust onto the street in front of horrified onlookers. I never mentioned onlookers or dust. But the film does show a bullet penetrating the passenger side of the windshield right next to the chrome on the side, and it shows glass spraying back into the car and alongside the car and down onto the street. It shows it. And it either really happened or it's another incident of how the film has been doctored to deceive us. And to me, I don't care which it is. It proves conspiracy. And that's what I'm after. I want these people caught and tried and hung. Hung. All of them. The ones involved in the assassination and the ones who have covered it up for this many years. All of them. Even those men who sat on the Warren Commission. Because they are accomplices. Under the law, if they help to cover it up, they're just as guilty as the man who pulled the trigger. Understand that. And that's what scares these people to death. They're shivering in their boots that the public will ultimately find out who the assassins really were and who the accomplices in the conspiracy and the cover-up really are. So, here we go. He then proceeds to regale his audience with a 10-minute monologue on his expertise on the subject of sniper etiquette, underscoring this with his implied authority in that area. As dozens of questions danced in our heads, oh, your little children, is it Christmas time? One we puzzled over was, just how does a Navy AV boy trying to insult me and emasculate me with the same terminology that they have used on blacks for many, many years, boy, who set up slide projectors and passed out paperwork for a Pacific Fleet briefing team, become such an expert on the fine art of military precision riflery? This person even professes to know what I did on the intelligence briefing team of the Commander-in-Chief of the Pacific Fleet. And he doesn't. Well, folks, when I was in Vietnam, I was a patrol boat captain, one of the few enlisted men in the history of this country who have served as commanding officers aboard combat vessels in time of war. And I performed my duties with distinction, earning many combat medals, two with the V for Valor. I'm proud of my military service. And I'm also proud of the fact that not one member of my crew, while they were actually under my command, were ever wounded or killed. Although we participated in combat almost on a nightly basis on the Tacon River near the DMZ. I was frequently assigned Marine recon teams who were placed under my command and were on my boat, my vessel, and I could use them in any manner that I saw fit. I generally inserted them somewhere along the riverbank to set up a LP, or listening post, or an ambush position. Occasionally, I was assigned a Marine sniper team. And one of the people who frequently rode with me on the boat was one of the best Marine snipers who's ever lived, a Hispanic gentleman. He was a young man at that time. And I'm not going to mention his name because he may not want the world to know that he was a sniper and has killed many, many people. But he taught me everything I know about sniping and marksmanship. And I am an expert marksman. And I'm going to tell you right now that no sniper, no assassin would ever, ever pick a position with the target moving from left to right in front of him or from right to left in front of him, but would instead pick the target of choice, which is a stationary target. And if he could not find a stationary target, he would choose to have the target second coming directly toward him, because as the target comes directly toward a marksman, the target appears to get bigger in the scope, and it is easier to hold your sight picture. The third target of choice would be a target moving directly away from the assassin or the sniper. The fourth is a target moving obliquely. The last preference, and most snipers and assassins would never even consider it, is a target moving from left to right, or right to left, directly in front of you when you're using a scope or open sights. It doesn't make any difference. You're almost guaranteed to miss. And the closer the target is and the faster the target is moving, the less likely you are to hit the target. So the assertion that there was an assassin on the grassy knoll is absolutely absurd, although there may have been someone up there firing off blanks to confuse the crowd. And I believe that that is probably the case. I have been to the grassy knoll. I'm going to tell you something else, folks. There's trees, there's brush, there's signs, there's all kinds of things that would interfere with an assassin from the grassy knoll. And most of these so-called people that they show hiding in the bushes are nothing more than the play of light and shadow. And you can take any tree and photograph it with the light and shadow coming through the tree, and you can sit down and ponder it for a while and trace the outlines of people and dinosaurs and monkeys and flowers and anything else that your deluded little brain wants to see. So, we will continue. We will continue. First and foremost, let's back up one. Anyone with a good Kennedy assassin library and videotape collection will find it immediately clear that Secret Service agent William Greer never pulled a weapon of any kind and delivered the fatal shot. Another lie. Millions of people around the world have looked at the Kennedy assassination tape after I have told them what I have found in it, and have agreed, concurred with me 100% that William Greer turned around and shot the president in the head. Some people can't see that. Some people disagree. Some people say it's a reflection on the top of Agent Kellerman's head. But this person's assertion that any one of you can look at the film and see that William Greer never drew a gun and never shot the president is a lie, because millions of people have looked at the film and have found exactly that, folks. And he continues, first and foremost, Mr. Cooper, how is it that not one of the witnesses ever bothered to mention in hours and hours of interviews that they had seen the glass burst and shatter, as you claim, from the front windshield? Why do the first still photographs and film shot just seconds after the limousine's arrival at Parker Memorial Hospital? Listen to me, you little socialist twit. It's Parkland Hospital, not Parker Memorial Hospital. Parkland. Parkland. You talk to me, get your facts straight. Why do they clearly show blood, roses, and personal effects, as well as Agent Greer talking on the car radio while in the driver's seat, yet the windshield is fully intact? I don't know. I haven't seen that picture. Send it to me. I'll be happy to look at it, and we'll analyze it, find out if it's a real photograph, and we will make comments based upon what we find. But I haven't seen it. I haven't seen any photograph like that. I have seen photographs that are purported to be Kennedy's limousine, which are really Johnson's limousine with Mrs. Johnson's roses laying in the back seat. I have seen that. Well, folks, I think it's time to take a little break here, so hang on. Don't go anywhere. We will be right back after this short pause.
Use Apex, the bone cleanser. Clean butts and pans, just like a whiz.
Ajax cuts grease faster than any other leading cleanser.
Use Amazing Elbow Patch, and use that cleaning with Ajax.
Ajax really polishes as it cleans.
So use Ajax, the foaming cleanser. Plug the dirt right down the drain.
My gosh, they're right. Foaming action Ajax makes even the dirtiest pan shine like new in a jiffy.
So use Ajax!
I collect old radio commercials from the 50s, from the 40s when I can find them from radio, from the 60s, any old radio commercials. I just like them, so every once in a while during my show I play them. Well, let's get on with this thing. I played that one, folks, because it was appropriate, I think. Just touching this slimy thing makes me feel dirty. We needed some Ajax right then. Well, let's continue here. Continue with this scumbag document full of lies. On page 146 of High Treason, there are three clear and pristine photographs. I like the way these socialists always use that word, pristine, as if the photograph is a virgin locked away in the tower of a castle somewhere, untouched by human hands. Well, these pristine photographs purported to contain a nick and a small crack in the limousine's windshield, as well as another bullet strike in the chrome frame above the windshield. We have that on our tape, too, on our film, the bullet strike in the chrome frame above the windshield. And he doesn't ask the question. He talks about how can the bullets penetrate bulletproof glass, but he doesn't say how this nick and small crack got in the limousine's windshield, if it was really there, and if it's a real picture. Most of the pictures that I've seen at Parkland that were purported to be Kennedy's limousine were really Johnson's limousine, and the flowers in the back seat were Lady Bird Johnson's flowers and not Mrs. Kennedy's. So, he says, the one basic question which begged to be asked was just how does one manage to completely blow out a bulletproof windshield anyway? Simple, folks. There's no such thing as a bulletproof windshield. There are bullets that will deflect or stop small caliber bullets. There are windshields that will slow down and take most of the energy out of a bullet as it comes through the windshield. But there are no bulletproof windshields that will stop all calibers with all loads. Understand that. I can take a 30-30 and make it armor-piercing just by drilling a hole at the end of the lead and inserting a stainless steel rod or a piece of bronze rod in the end of it. And you can do. You see, there's also exploding projectiles which will penetrate these things. So don't get carried away in the myth of bulletproof glass. It's a myth. And they say that they can't see the Emperor's new clothes as their ringmaster and self-appointed king. Mr. Bill Cooper forces them to choose between being swept into the mass hysteria he creates or being swiftly labeled stupid, ignorant, or blind. During this hour show, Mr. Cooper also reached into his bag of tricks to present his ludicrous story about the secret plan to ignite Jupiter to create a binary star system for a Club Med of sorts for little demonoid gray aliens. Another lie, never mentioned anything about demonoid gray aliens, or aliens of any kind for that matter, except to say that most people saw 2001 and thought it was all about extraterrestrials. It wasn't. It was about the god of Mystery Babylon, Lucifer. Lucifer. And the obelisks or monoliths represented Lucifer. And you saw that the monkeys, after they had already been created by the real god, were imparted intellect by this monolith, Lucifer. Go watch the movie again. If you're really smart and you've studied the symbology of the mystery schools, you'll be able to figure all this stuff out eventually. Then he says, when two callers late, he or she or organization or whoever wrote this, when two callers late in his show disagreed with King Coop and questioned how he could possibly believe this scenario, he stated, quote, scientists involved directly with the project told me this, unquote. I have talked with scientists directly involved with the project of the Galileo space probe and scientists who have nothing to do with it. Some of them have said, yes, that's exactly what's going to happen. Jupiter will be ignited. Others have said that it will not happen, that it's impossible, and that Jupiter is not big enough to be ignited by any amount of plutonium. Others have said, yes, it could happen. The truth is, nobody knows if it's going to happen or not. But the original plan that I saw when I was with Naval Intelligence said that they were going to send 5 pounds of plutonium to Jupiter to ignite the protostar and make this a binary solar system. You can believe it or not. We're all going to find out eventually, I guarantee you. And I'm entitled to my opinion, and this is what my opinion is that is exactly what the Galileo space probe is intended to do. It goes on, when one of these callers demonstrated the fact that he had a mind of his own and that this scenario was scientifically absurd, Mr. Cooper, always the advocate of free speech, responded by yelling for the program's moderator to flip the switch immediately. I've had enough of this, gentlemen. Well, that's not really what happened, folks, and I did not yell. In any conversation, especially on radio, on a talk show, when the conversation gets to the point where there is no productive reason for it, beyond that point, it's time to quit. Since the gentleman would not quit and would not hang up, I told the moderator to flip the switch and get him off the air. Because the conversation had reached a point where he said tisn't, and I said tis, and he said tisn't, and I said tis, and that is what is absurd, folks. And every talk show host does it every time any conversation ever reaches that point. Larry King does it. Everybody does it. Simply because it is no longer a productive conversation. And if the caller doesn't have the good sense to understand when the conversation is over and hang up the phone, then the host has to do it for him. And if I ever go on live again and taking callers, and it reaches that point again in the conversation, I will flip the switch. And this continues, saying, during his program, Mr. Cooper again stated that the reason for his sudden relocation from his also recent move to Camp Verde, Arizona, was due to a particularly frightening episode in which unknown military intelligence special operations troops surrounded his home in the middle of the night, forcing him to evacuate with his wife and young daughter. Blatant lies. Blatant lies, folks. I never said that they were unknown military intelligence special operations troops. I don't know who they were or who they belonged to, but they were in helicopters. There were 3 helicopters. Troops did deploy around my home, and then they left. We did not evacuate. I got out my weapons and prepared to fight. Luckily, I did not have to. They left. The next day, we began preparations to move, and we did move. This person or persons or organization goes on to say, well, there's a germ of truth in this scenario, but after interviewing his Camp Verde neighbors, it seems that Mr. Cooper's love of the bottle and his alcoholic delusions have elaborated a bit on what was, in reality, a few squad cars of Arizona's finest on yet another domestic violence call to Mr. Cooper's residence. A blatant lie. Blatant lie. No one has ever interviewed any of my neighbors about me ever at all. No Arizona police officers or federal police officers or any other kind of police officers have ever been to my Camp Verde residence ever in the entire time that I lived there. And there's never been any domestic violence at my home. In fact, I've never harmed anybody. Period. If I were attacked, I would not hesitate to do so, however. And you're going to hear right now what the real truth is, so hang on to your hats. Earlier today, I called Stan and Elma Barrington, who lived right across the street from me, and read them this thing. So now you're going to hear, I've got them on the phone, you're going to hear their comments as to the truth or falsity of this piece of trash. Well, folks, we're on the phone with Stan and Elma Barrington, who lived directly across the street from me in Camp Verde. And anything that ever went on at my house, they knew about it instantly, immediately, in fact. Hello, Stan.
Hi. How's it going, Bill?
Fine. Elma?
All right, I'm here.
How are you?
Fine, thank you.
Listen, I've read to you earlier this whole piece about what supposedly happened to Camp Verde, about there were no helicopters, and supposedly the police were at my house for domestic violence repeatedly. Are you hearing me okay?
Yes, we are.
Okay, we're getting these clicks on the phone. I have no idea what those are. Can you comment on that, Stan?
Yeah, I've known you, Bill, for probably about 4 years now. And since we used to live right across the street from each other, I had daily and or nightly contact with you throughout the entire time that you were in our area. And we never, to my knowledge, had any police that was ever come to your house for any reason whatsoever. I know that on or about the 15th of March of this year, there was 3 helicopters that did drop in on you around about 2:30 in the morning. Repel personnel down rope, came up close to your home, stayed for a few minutes, and then reported the choppers and left. And I'm assuming that they were telling you, hey, I know where you are, we just want to intimidate you. And Lord, who lives next door by the name of Bob, did confirm that he did see the 3 choppers that particular morning.
Have you ever in your life, Stan, seen me drunk?
Never.
Okay, you and I have had a couple of drinks together, haven't we?
Sure, yes.
Have I ever hurt anybody or threatened anybody or beat my wife or any of those things?
No, you have never done that to my knowledge.
Have you ever seen any police come to my house for any reason?
No, I have not.
Okay, thank you, Stan. Elma,
yes.
What have you got to say about all this?
Well, I've seen you have a drink or two, too.
Uh-huh.
It makes you happier and more relaxed.
That's true.
Good part of the whole thing.
Have you ever known me to beat my wife or be unkind to anyone or to have domestic violence, as this thing says?
No, it's the opposite.
Well, thank you, Elma.
You love your family and you love us and everybody else.
Well, thank you.
You're very welcome.
I want to have you two on the show at a better time when we're not besieged with this kind of thing, and I'm sorry that your first appearance on the Hour of the Time had to be under these conditions. But we'll do it again and talk about our 4 years together and what we've done and all of the consequences of it that both of our families have suffered at some later time. Thank you both very much.
Okay, Bill. You have a good one now.
You too.
We love you.
Bye-bye, Elma.
Bye-bye.
And so there you have it, from Stan and Elma Barrington, who lived right across the street from me in Camp Verde. These little abject, miserable cowards who wrote this pack of lies, if we can find out who they are, we're going to take them into a court of law and rake them over the coals. So, again, I want to reiterate, $100 reward for the identity of whoever wrote this, plus a free membership to CAGI. Plus, we'll even give you a free copy of our documentary, which, by the way, is going to cost $200 for non-CAGI members and $100 for CAGI members. It's 7 hours in length. So you will be endowed with great reward if you can take us to the doorstep of whoever wrote this. Now, the racial parts. These people are racist also. They claim in here, listen to this. It says, this information contained photographs of a recent meeting Mr. Cooper had with Minister Louis Farrakhan, Nation of Islam, at Mr. Farrakhan's request. After this 4-hour meeting, the Nation of Islam and Minister Louis Farrakhan had a new addition to their list of mandatory reading for a member of the Nation of Islam. That's right, Behold a Pale Horse by William Cooper. Again, blatant lies. I've never met Mr. Louis Farrakhan in my entire life. If I ever have a chance to meet with him and sit down and talk to him, I will relish that chance and will certainly do it. It says here that my book is mandatory reading. Well, I don't believe that anybody in the world except a drill sergeant at boot camp can make anything mandatory. And I don't believe that Minister Farrakhan has made my book mandatory, although I do know that he has recommended it to his people. And I thank him for that, and I am honored that he believes that my book is so important that he has personally recommended that all of the members of the Nation of Islam read it. I'm honored. Thank you. I do apologize to Mr. Farrakhan and to his people for having their name put through this piece of trash here, and because they've been used to try to intimidate me with the implications that a meeting between me and a black man is somehow a terrible thing. You see, I don't think it is. I'm against racism in any form, no matter who the racist is. Black, white, Oriental, Hispanic, I don't care. Racist is scum. And he continues, he says, so has Mr. Cooper succeeded in manipulating Mr. Farrakhan, or is Mr. Farrakhan being a master of manipulation, brilliantly using Mr. Cooper and his trickery to Mr. Farrakhan's own ultimate design? Well, you can make up your own minds about that. Since I've never met Mr. Farrakhan, I fail to see how he can be manipulating me or I him. And he goes on to say that I worship at the temple of the power-hungry ego in the church of the Almighty Buck. More socialist dribble. More socialist dribble. I have a healthy ego, I'm self-confident, I love myself, and thus can love others. This person is obviously suffering from an ego deficit. And yes, in the United States of America, all of us need to feed our families, and we need to do it by our own efforts, not through welfare or socialism or anything else. And since this is what I do, yes, if you want the results of what I do, yes, you're going to have to pay for it. And I am not ashamed of that at all. In fact, I'm very proud of the fact that I don't work for anyone else to support myself from my own efforts. I do not believe in socialism as apparently this little twit does. Goes on to say, although WWCR broadcasts Mr. Cooper's Hour of the Slime, he calls it, please don't think that its entire programming schedule is reprehensible, because WWCR does have reputable broadcasting such as Tom Valentine and Chuck Harder's For the People, both of whom ask you for money, both of whom sell products on their show, and Chuck Harder even has a hotel that he asks you to come to sleep in and stay and pay for, and a restaurant to eat in. And they sell books and a whole bunch of other things. But it's okay. These guys are reputable. You see how warped the thinking of these socialist twits really is? Then he tries to say that he's for free speech. All the while, this whole tome, the objective of this whole thing, is to get me taken off the air and suppress free speech. Typical socialist ploy. Says nearly everyone supports the concept of free speech. This allows great freedom to the radio show personalities themselves, as well as those who agree or disagree with him. However, when lies, half-truths, and exaggerations are used in purposeful attempt to manipulate people purely for monetary gain, these same people will eventually end up shutting out all legitimate truth-seekers trying to educate the uninformed. Thus, we, as well as the truth, all suffer at the hands of charlatans and crackpots like Mr. Cooper. And this language is what is going to get this person either locked up or have all of his assets transferred over to me. Get to work, folks. Find out who this person is so that we can take them to task. We have had two lengthy conversations, he says, with the investigators at Time Warner, as well as forwarding a tape of the October 19th sham to them. So rest assured, with your help at getting this news out, we can rid ourselves of these bait-and-switch Bush League con men. If you are outraged by what you've heard here, please let your voice be heard. Mr. Cooper oft-times speaks of the people of this great country as sheep. Most people in this country and everywhere else are sheep, folks, and I will continue to say that. Not only sheep, but stupid sheep. Most of the listeners of this show, though, are free-thinking leaders who are not sheep and don't believe everything that they hear. They conduct their own research, and they are people who make things happen, not watch things happen. Well, now, he goes on to say, he has appointed himself their new shepherd, but instead of leading his flock to greener pastures, he leads them to a shearing. Mr. Cooper and the disservice he is doing to our country must be stopped. Criminal and fraudulent behavior is not protected under the First Amendment. Please let the individuals and organizations involved know your true feelings at this injustice. They will only know if you tell them. All socialist crap. Claptrap crap, that's right. Dribble. Which is a lie. I've set myself up as England's shepherd. I impart information, I tell you what I think, what I believe, and I tell you not to believe what you hear on this show or any other show, and not to believe anything that you read unless you can substantiate it by your own investigations. And this hurts these creeps, because they can't control you if you're a free thinker. At the end of his show, Mr. Cooper pleaded for listeners who wanted to be good Americans and hear the truth that they should demonstrate that they want his program to continue by sending him $45 for a one-year membership. That's right, folks. If you want to be a part of the best and largest and most effective civilian intelligence organization in the world, join CAGI, the Citizens Agency for Joint Intelligence. Send in $45, your membership fee, to William Cooper, P.O. Box 3299, Camp Verde, Arizona, 86322. That's P.O. Box 3299, Camp Verde, Arizona, 86322. We'll send you a big packet of information. If you just want that so that you can make your decision at a later time, I also suggest that you purchase my book, Behold a Pale Horse. It's $20 for members, plus $5 postage and handling, $25 for non-members, plus $5 postage and handling. It's 500 pages of the most well-documented suppressed information ever published in the history of the world. Been told that by experts. It's the only book in the world that's guaranteed. So do it, folks. Now, he goes on to say, please let WWCR Radio know that Mr. Cooper falls far short of their established standard by contacting. Now, this is going all over the place, folks, so I'm going to have to ask you to do something for me. I very seldom ever ask you to do anything for me. In fact, I don't remember ever asking you to do anything for me. I've asked you to do things for yourself and for this country, for the Constitution, for freedom, but never for me. But tonight, I'm going to ask you to do something for me, folks. Please do this. Write down this address. Write down this address right now. WWCR Radio, 1300 WWCR Avenue. That's 1300 WWCR Avenue. Nashville, Tennessee. Nashville, Tennessee. And the zip is 37218. 37218. That's WWCR Radio, 1300 WWCR Avenue, Nashville, Tennessee, 37218. Or you can call, address your letter attention, Adam Locke. Adam Locke, L-O-C-K. Tell them what you really think of this show, whether it's good or bad, I don't care, but I want them to hear from our listeners, not from a bunch of socialist twits who read this tome and think it's really true. Okay, folks? Make sure you do that. It's important. I'm asking you to do that for me. If you want to see this show stay on the air, please write WWCR. Tell them what you think about this show. Tell them what you think about what you heard tonight. I hope that you've all recorded this and that you distribute it far and wide. This is an example of what socialism propaganda is all about. It can destroy people, individuals, states and nations can crumble, religions. Any organization can be subject to this kind of trash and attack. This is McCarthyism backwards. And so we've gotten through another edition of the Hour of the Time. Well, now that that's out of the way, folks, we're going to go back to our old policy of ignoring these kinds of attacks. But I had to do one show addressing it. It had to be done, and I'm sure that you will understand why. Please write WWCR at the address we gave you, 1300 WWCR Avenue, Nashville, Tennessee, 37218. Also, make sure that you order my book and send in your $45 for your CAGI membership. Good night, and God bless you all.
Tomorrow all the things were gone, worked for all my life, and I had to start again, with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, but the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. Across the plains, from Detroit down to Houston.